Hello, I'm Simon Smale. I'm a gastroenterologist in York. Welcome to More Than Just Medicine. This evening I'm going to talk a bit about Barrett's esophagus. First, to define it, Barrett's esophagus is an esophagus where it's clear that the lining has changed from being what's called squamous mucosa, which is what the skin is, to columnar mucosa, which is similar to the lining within the intestine. Such changes are visible endoscopically, and instead of getting a nice clear line at the lower end of the gullet as it transitions into the stomach, one finds that there is gastric mucosa, either in patches or as a continuous lining within the gullet rather than being confined to the stomach. That diagnosis is generally confirmed by biopsy, which is reviewed by a pathologist, so someone that looks at biopsies and the appearance of cells under the microscope. Usually Barrett's occurs in people who've had a long history of reflux, but that's not always the case, or at least symptomatically they're not always symptomatic. And it reflects a biological mechanism for the esophagus trying to protect itself from acid exposure, because after all the stomach has lots of acid in it, designed to have acid in it because it helps digest your food and kill the bugs that we eat. And therefore if you expose the gullet to acid, rather than being corroded as skin is when it's exposed to acid, it changes the lining to be of a columnar nature, so more like that which lines the stomach. So in a way there's a biological reason why the mucosa changes in people with long-standing reflux. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important because Barrett's esophagus over a lifetime carries a slightly increased risk for those patients in developing esophageal cancer. The estimated risk is probably somewhere around the region of 10 times greater than those patients who don't have Barrett's over a lifetime in terms of developing esophageal cancer. Now, there are a number of features both within the patients who have Barrett's and within the Barrett's segments itself which further increase the risk of cancer. Again, only a small amount for each facet, but a small amount nevertheless. Those include patients who are male, who have an increased risk, and patients who smoke. So those are the patient features. And then in terms of the Barrett's segment itself, the length of the segment clearly has an impact on the risk of cancer, as does the development of changes which are called intestinal metaplasia. Now essentially when one looks under the microscope, all that means is that the columnar mucosa looks a bit more like that which you would normally expect in the intestine, as opposed to straightforward columnar mucosa, if you like, that looks a bit like bricks on one end all lined up together. So one looks out for those changes, and endoscopically what happens is you can't usually see it endoscopically with normal endoscopes, but endoscopists usually experienced in Barrett's surveillance who have an interest in it will take quadrantic biopsies, so four biopsies every couple of centimetres, along with biopsies of any abnormal looking area within the Barrett's. And they will be examined very carefully by somebody expert in that field, a pathologist. Now, the risk of intestinal metaplasia per year in terms of development of cancer is probably somewhere in the region of 1 in 200 to 1 in 400. So it's still very small, but significant if you happen to be the one person that gets it. Similarly, the risks of having a long segment of Barrett's esophagus are greater than a short segment. It's estimated the risk of a segment less than 3 centimetres is probably less than 1 in 500. For that reason, the current UK guidance suggests that we don't undertake regular endoscopy people with a less than 3 centimetre segment, because the risks for endoscopy are greater than the risks of an esophageal cancer developing. So, those are the features of the Barretts which increase risk. But what do we look for on top of that when we're undertaking regular surveillance? Well, we look for a thing called dysplasia. And there are grades of dysplasia. There's a thing called low-grade dysplasia. And then there's a high-grade dysplasia, which is more uncommon, but more worrisome. Firstly, low-grade dysplasia. Mindful of the things which increase the risk, the overall risk of developing low-grade dysplasia over a decade or two is probably somewhere in the region of 1 in 10 or 10%. Most people never get dysplasia of any sort. Now, if you take those people who have low-grade dysplasia, then the risks of them developing high-grade dysplasia, which is a much more worrying finding, again, it's probably about 1 in 10 over decades or more. That's an estimation. High-grade dysplasia is important, and if it's found, it needs confirmation, sometimes by repeat endoscopy, but certainly by review by a number of experts. And then it requires an action plan in order to treat it appropriately. I hope that's of some help in explaining a little bit more about Barrett's esophagus and what it means. Obviously, the findings at endoscopy define the intervals for surveillance. And if you have dysplasia, particularly low-grade dysplasia, the current UK guidance suggests you should have 6-monthly surveillance. Whereas if you have no dysplasia, the surveillance interval is much longer. I hope that's of some help. Thank you for listening.